Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here. Our keynote speaker for today is Willie Koortz, who has come up from the Astronomical Observatory in Sutherland. He also works in the observatory head office in Cape Town. Before we go any further, I'd like to remind you, please, can you mute your cell phones? Right. Now, Willie's got a very long CV, and I tried to print it, but I ran out of toner, you see. So I will just tell you that he's a long-term friend of the astronomical community. He's a telescope maker as his hobby. He is an instrument designer, maker. He's written software to track satellites, which is quite a challenge, right? Because they move fast and they vary in speed. And he's all-around good guy, and he's going to tell you something about the history of space exploration, because next month, in October, it will be 60 years since Sputnik 1 was put into orbit, the first man-made satellite and man's first step outside of our atmosphere. So, without further ado, welcome, Willie. Thank you. We all look forward to it.
Well, I'm starting like the Bible does. So, in the beginning, there was one lonely moon around the Earth, also a satellite, of course. The history we always think about Sputnik, but there's a Chinese legend that Wang Hu is a guy who took a bamboo chair, tied 47 rockets to it, had 47 helpers, all rushing forward, lit the rockets, a huge cloud of smoke. After the smoke cleared, Wang Hu was gone. We don't know if he's in orbit or whatever, but his legend still lives on today. So maybe he was the one who invented space flight. So unfortunately, we would not know what happened to Wang Hu. The person who should be standing here is Greg Roberts, and you're going to hear his name a lot during my talk. Just a show of hands, who knows about Greg Roberts and seen him? Yeah, so there's a few people. Greg Roberts, at the age of about 8, he got interested in astronomy, wanted to study astronomy. His dad said, get a real job, and he took him, put him to university to study chemistry. Then the space age began, and he had enough chemistry to mix rocket fuels and stuff, and he got all bogged down in rockets. He plucked his first year. His dad didn't like him at all, and then of course Sputnik 1 and all the others, and he started going on to satellite tracking, and then he finally finished his studies, went and worked in the Cape at a petrochemical company. There was actually an opening for satellite tracking at the observatory in Cape Town. He grabbed the job because it was just a part-time thing, and so he was holding a job at during the day and satellite tracking at night. He was in his sort of like what he was doing. Then there was an opportunity to become an astronomer, and he became an astronomer. And actually, after retirement, that's where I helped him set up a automated mount, which unfortunately I don't have time for in this talk. I thought I'll fill up the talk with that, but there's actually just too much in the end to do. Yeah. So Greg is really the person who should be here. His wife is quite ill right now. He is 78 at the moment, and he doesn't like traveling anymore. So I tried to say, you must give this talk. I'll tell you a bit more about this telescope he's holding right there. So maybe just a few basics for people who don't understand rocketry. To get something in orbit, you need to give it enough forward speed. So if you were at this mountain, and you put the cannon on top of the mountain, and you point it level, If you put in a little bit of gunpowder there, the ball will finally fall. So you put in a bit more and it goes a bit further. And if you put in enough, started to read this speed, which is about 28,600 kilometers an hour, I think. As the ball is falling, the Earth is falling away under it. So it is basically in orbit. And that's, of course, why people are weightless when they're up there, because they're falling all the time. And so if you put more gunpowder in, what will happen then is if that was your mountain, you put enough in, you've got that orange track. If you put a bit more in, it'll just do an oval. And, of course, you still have the world's best boomerang. You still have to duck because it's going to come past you again. And if you keep putting in more, you'll have more orbits until you finally just make it escape. So that's roughly sort of why things stay in orbit. The satellites are pretty close to the Earth, really, and they're in a plane. It says an orbital plane, and they basically go around in a plane. So if you look at it from the side or from the satellite's point of view, and the Earth is, of course, turning under it. So we like to flatten the Earth, and, of course, if you flatten the Earth, you have to curve the plane. So that is the typical picture that you see in NASA's control rooms and whatever, and you see them in programs. And this is actually from www.heavensabove.com, a very useful website if you want interested in satellite tracking. For a satellite to be visible, two things need to happen. The satellite needs to be in sunlight, and you need to be in the dark. Well, you can see satellites during the day if they're very bright, but that doesn't happen often. So basically the sun's shining from that side, so all of this is daytime. There's the twilight zone, and people in this zone here will see the satellite go round and just before it enters the Earth's shadow. And of course in the morning again, you see satellites come out of sunlight in that area. That's where you see most satellites just after twilight or before twilight in the mornings. In the summer, the Earth's shadow is much higher much lower, and then you can see satellites deeper into the night. So that is just roughly. And this is also something that Greg told me. You often see in the movies that they want to observe somewhere, and they move the satellites, and you even see those tracks moving, and the satellite's in position, and it can take that spy picture. In real life, it is not so easy. So if you think about a railway line, it's easy to move the trucks up and down the railway line, and that is moving the satellite up and down into the orbit. But to move the whole orbit is like moving the railway line. And it's possible, but you just need much more energy. So that is basically, so what you see in the movies is possible, but normally there's not enough energy available to do that. So South Africa was very strategically placed, and it still is today, because you always launch a satellite from west to east. That is to take advantage of the Earth spin. There are a few satellites that go the other way. Some nations don't have sea to launch over. You, of course, would be very foolish to try and launch over a city, because anything goes wrong, you know, it's basically a controlled bomb you've got there. So they always try and launch over the sea. So from America, they can either launch from Vandenberg on the east coast, on the west coast, or from Florida on the east coast. And even those, they mostly fly over South Africa. And so we are the first landmass downrange, and South Africa played a vital role in the first satellite launches. So from the mid 57 to almost the end of 58, it was declared the International Geographical Year, the IGY, and about 67 countries partook in this. And 11 sciences was taken into consideration. And interestingly enough, most people only remember the launches, because that's what took people's attention. And America was planning to do 6 launches during the IGY. Then 2 years before, because they expected the first launches to be in 58, they started planning, they started getting stuff together. Just tracking the satellite was quite important, because we didn't know much about the outer atmosphere. We didn't quite know how the densities were. Is it smooth? Does it end up roughly? Does it have valleys and whatever? So all of this, even just tracking the rocket bodies, there's a lot of scientific value in that to understand our own atmosphere, because we've never been out there, not with anything else that's remotely has a probe on it, and even so, three methods, radio, photographic, and visual, were proposed, and they were actually all used in the end. Amateur astronomers were, of course, the ideal candidates to do this, especially if you needed a lot of people, because they knew how to track things and knew how telescopes work, all sorts. You can rattle off a lot of reasons why. And observatories were just as ideal, because they had time service. You needed accurate time. You also needed your position quite accurately. Most observatories knew their position quite accurately. Most of them had a telex machine or just got a telex machine. That was important to get the notifications from America. And then some of them even had optical expertise and workshops to make telescopes, and you'll see in a minute why. So the Smithsonian Institute in Massachusetts then created this Moonwatch program. Moonwatch sounds funny. They're not looking at the moon, but as we said, it's an artificial moon, a satellite you can think of as an artificial moon. Johannesburg and Pretoria were the first to register, and Cape Town and Bloemfontein followed. PE, unfortunately, was turned down. Now, the previous speaker said about the huge amounts of money that was available, but they were also, of course, they had to set a lot of stuff into place. So there were budgets to work within, and so PE had to be turned down. They were initially thinking of 15 telescopes per station, and the way they work is they would basically set up an optical fence. You'll see the next slide, and so you basically have a group of telescopes looking up in the sky, and the satellite's got to pass somewhere in there. Remember the first orbits were very unknown. We're just talking about getting a rocket in the sky. Never mind exactly where it should go. Now, if any of you have listened to the Cassini fall into Saturn yesterday, it's just amazing to think how far we've gone. Where they needed this kind of thing, and lots of people looking up in the sky, find a satellite somewhere in there, against to the second be able to predict when a thing is going to fall into Saturn's atmosphere. That just boggled my mind when I looked at this. And this is this lone wolf thing. Greg Roberts was out in Durban at the time, and he was the ones that wasn't going to be part of this, and he actually felt a bit bad, obviously because he was this keen person. So this is roughly how it worked. So you had a row of telescopes set up on a north-south line, and each one's field overlapped with the next one. They had this funny, strange system. You can see here's the mast, and you can see this is the pillars. To set up the telescopes, I'm not sure how it works, but you have this, and you'll see from the pictures, you can see the telescopes are fanning out. So you basically, somewhere in there, the satellite's going to pass over. And then, and the way it worked is they would then, so sometimes more than one observer will see the satellite come through. The person will say satellite or whatever they said before they will say as it comes into the field. And then people will stand ready with stopwatches. And as it crosses the meridian markings on the graticule on the telescope, there were also latitude stuff. And I think this is to do with the setup. They will then shout, and then people will start their stopwatches and then stop it on to it the next minute of a time, and then determine the exact time when it went through the field. And if it was more than one telescope, they will have another person sort of taking that time, and then determine the position that way. So that was the initial idea. So the first thing is they were setting up these 2-inch telescopes. 50 millimeter aperture, 5.5 power, 10 to 12 degrees. They differed because it depends on what lenses they got, which gave them about a magnitude 8 limit, what they could see. Again, because of the money being scarce, there were commercial ones. You'll see in a further picture. Then there were homemade ones, and this one here was actually produced in the workshops of the old Union Observatory, which is the observatory here in Johannesburg, for 15 shillings. In Bloemfontein, they also got the workshops there making telescopes, and you can see this is the way they were set up. So you can see the angle differs slightly, and so what I meant to say that they have a little mirror at the bottom. Some of you that seen Johan's telescope, that's a similar system. That is just because you were expected to be that satellite could arrive anywhere within 90 minutes. So you had to sit there for 90 minutes staring through this thing, waiting for a satellite to come through the field. And initially they didn't even know how bright they were going to be. So of course the commercial guys immediately jumped in as well. And a lot of them were produced. I found this YouTube video of a guy who's got a whole collection. And you see, there's the original one from Edmund Scientific, which is the 2-inch one with a mirror at the bottom. So the others were just... later on, Edmund just applied the lenses, and people would make them up, as you've seen in some of these. They also used ex-army stock. The M15, some gun sight or something, actually had better optical quality than the other one. Slightly smaller field, the other one was 8 degrees, this is 6 degrees, and it could go down slightly deeper. And a total of 36 were supplied to South Africa, but they seem to have not been used a lot. And you still see them on some telescope. I think in Bloemfontein I saw one of these on the Boyden 1.5 meter. So by mid-75, 57, the Johannesburg got 16 volunteers, and you see Bloemfontein was really hyped up about satellite tracking now. And it's interesting, you'll see these numbers being turned around later on. As soon as people figured out what does it mean, get up 4 in the morning, drive out to Boyden, and what. And I also think it's to do with Johannesburg, those low numbers is Finson was quite fussy on who he took on. He basically screened these people where the others just said, okay, everybody come along. This is the only remains of a satellite tracking in South Africa that I know of. So these are the pillars which I think were the 2 inches originally. Because you'll see later on of the other telescopes, those pillars doesn't exist anymore. And this little hut is still there today. I actually managed to break it open the other day. The key is long gone. And there's unfortunately not too much left in it. Right, so the moment of truth, the 4th of October, 1957, the Russians stunned the world with the first... Now, are you going to play or not? And suddenly there's this thing up in the sky. You could take your shortwave radio, you can tune into it, and you can hear it go over, and you could see it go over as well. Of course, what they saw was not the satellite, it was actually the rocket. So suddenly this thing, the space race was on. The Americans were saying that they will only launch next year. And it took America 12 years to sort of regain. Professor Spargo, he wrote some memoirs, and he was part of the Moonwatch team up here in Johannesburg. And he, which way is the observatory? Am I pointing the right way? It's the observatory that way. Yeah, anyway, the one here in observatory in Johannesburg. He was actually the youngest member of the team. And you can see that picture was taken about 2 years ago. So that's the problem. The not many of the people that were involved in this are alive today. And he kept a diary, and this was the thing on his. So that's 5th of October. I worked on calculus. He added later until 5:30. He was a student then. Fetched the paper of Veranda, started news of the Russian Earth satellite. I dragged Dr. Williams, and we went up to the observatory. We picked up the radio signals from the satellite at 9:05. Today is the big day, blah, blah. Yeah, so I'm sorry, the Russians got it first. So, of course, everybody was now behind the Americans because they were doing this American program, obviously. So, Finson, the director of the Union Observatory at the time, As I remember, it was a Saturday morning that the news broke of the launching of Sputnik 1. The office was bedlam, phone ringing constantly, reporters, etc. No time at all to sit down and sort things out. No hard information from overseas, only test predictions. It is such that the times of Sputnik would be over, but none of South African cities were mentioned. And of course, everybody wanted to know from him, when is the thing going to fly over? So he went to his workshop and he made up he calls it a slide rule, if you like. In fact, in the next slide, you will see a three-dimensional slide rule. And here is Finson sort of explaining it. Sort of jumping the gun here, but he actually became known as the South African witch doctor for... He suddenly learned how to do orbital predictions. It's not so difficult to determine when it's going to come over again. The difficult thing is if it's going to be sunlit or not, because it depends on, as you saw in that previous picture, it needs to be in the right place. And he was saying in one of his things, he went to the Baker Nun station, which I'll talk about now, a satellite tracking station by NASA, a professional station, that got their predictions from a NASA computer, because computers were only in the main center. And it said, these are the predictions, but believe Finson's predictions rather. So he really became of course, because the first launches were only expected in 58, nobody was ready. None of the professionals or the amateur stations. And parts were still on order, and of course the public wanted to know when and why. And the first thing they noticed is this thing is surprisingly bright. And you'll see in a moment why. Well, this actually was quite a big thing, where the American things were much smaller, you'll see just now. And Finson managed to take a picture of it. And of course, being a scientist, he put little shutters and whatever, so that's the minute pulse, and these are second pulses, etc. And Greg actually figured out exactly when it was taken. So this was within anybody off the street's ability to take a picture of the satellite. And of course, like I say, you can tune in on your radio. So I told about the papers trying to do their own predictions. And they caused somebody to fall to his death because the satellite was not going to be visible, and he leaned over apparently to try and see this thing past his flat balcony or something, and it fell over. So it was a dangerous business just tracking satellites as well. So this is just a timeline of the highlights. Of course, that's Sputnik 1, and it stayed in orbit for 3 months. And it's just amazing. You know, a month later, Sputnik 2 went up with Laika, and that was just the next one. You know, it's just amazing how the Russians were organized here. So in December 57, the Americans tried to launch, but they failed. They tried to launch 2 months later, and also failed. And then finally, I think they put so much gunpowder in there that the thing is still in orbit. Well, it stayed in orbit for 12 years. And the next one, you know, still in orbit today. So then, of course, Sputnik 3, again, three failed attempts by the Americans. They were obviously pushing very hard now. And in the meantime, the Russian says, well, let's aim for the moon. So the first one, they actually missed the moon. The second one, they crashed into the moon successfully. They meant it. And then they managed to go around the moon and take a picture of the first time of the back of the moon, which we haven't seen before then. Sputnik 4, still Russian. And then, that was two dogs. And then Yuri Gagarin. So it was just a suborbital flight, but he was out in space and he came back again alive. You've got to, obviously the reason why they use dogs and stuff is just to see can a human, or can a being survive out there, because there's all these radiation and stuff, which they knew nothing of. So there's a lot of, it's a big learning curve, and then the Americans followed with the first manned, and then the second manned mission, the second cosmonaut for the Russians, he got a bit sick, then America again, that guy's got some Bloemfontein connection, which I can't remember right now. The Russians put the first woman in space, and there was also thought about, will she be able to bear children again afterwards, and of course the astronauts as well, because of radiation and stuff, and she got pregnant, not right there, but later on. She was proved and then of course Neil Armstrong, as you saw in the previous. So finally the Americans were sort of back in the race. Yeah, so if you look at the sizes, so that was the Russian, the first Sputnik against the American Vanguard. Again, Vostok against the American, whatever that is, Mercury Atlas, yes. Soyuz, which is still in use today, the one that Shuttlesworth went up. And of course the Saturn V. And the shuttle is still for scale. Again, here you can see the size of which one was this Explorer. And you see some famous names, Pickering, Van Allen, and Van Allen belts are called, and Von Braun. But you see the size of the rocket. So then they realized that those 2-inch scopes were far too small for the American launches. So they had to soup up the telescope. So their answer was this so-called apogee scopes. So at the base of it, you can see the M17. So the M17 base, they just took the lens out and then mounted this 5-inch telescope at the top. And Cape Town and Bloemfontein were only supplied in the beginning, because they thought the American launches will never come up this high, but they were actually later sent up, as you will see, as we say there. Yeah. So this is just a picture. So they really flooded Cape Town. They got 50 down to Cape Town, and they were setting them up, and they were just optical fencing like it's going out of fashion there. The interesting thing is you see youngsters, you see older people, you see women. There were volunteers from all walks of life. They got some training, and everybody was into this thing. And this is also a picture of the Cape Town station. They actually, in fact, about only the first year when they really had so many telescopes, and then they found that if they actually used dedicated people doing much more accurate stuff, and of course these were amateurs, known amateurs. That's Rupert Hurley. You probably know if you've met Rupert. Yeah, so after he's deceased now. But so they later on went to smaller, dedicated people rather than these big teams. But that was only later on. That was in the second year or so. Greg Roberts, I just put this under Cape Town because in 68, you see this is much later now. This is when Greg was in Cape Town. He put his apogee scope on his balcony of his flat, and he wanted to do satellites. Now, Greg is now in an old age home, also a block of flats, and he's chosen his room specifically to have a certain view. He's still tracking satellites with an automated system. Bloemfontein started out at Boyden, actually, and which made sense because of the time service and everything. And people just quickly found that it's quite a slip to drive out there because it's 20-odd kilometers out of town. And if you have to do this at 4 in the morning, and sometimes the lawns get scrubbed, people got fed up. So they actually moved it into town onto the Naval Hill. So there's Lamont Hussey, and you see down there is the which is now the planetarium, and then down there I think there's the Mandela. I think it's down there. Anyway, there's a close-up. There's a radio tower there. If anybody wants to go and see where that is. So Bloemfontein, as the Cape and so forth, suddenly, sometimes got in the news because they were the first to see this and that and the other. And it was all nice and rewarding, obviously. Bloemfontein only lasted a year, and then they actually closed down. They just somehow, so after that initial 75 people, it dwindled down to sort of, and their secretary there was a lady. So down in Durban, I just include this as and of course this was all later now. In the beginning, as Greg said, there were no single or lone wolf people allowed into the Moonwatch network. There were other networks as well, and I'll show you in a minute what he joined. And then later on, so his rocketry guys, he got his rocketry guys interested, and they got some Apogee scopes as well and set them up. And it was only after he took this picture using his own prediction. So Greg was now also learning orbital, how to predict satellites, etc., and took this picture, sent it to somebody and said, "Wow, that's wonderful. Here's some scopes for you." And so they managed to get. So there's Greg in his young days, and another one there. And so they were really active. And in this article, if you can read there, they were actually asked for by the Baikonur station at Willefontein to track the satellite. So, I mean, this is now the professionals asking the amateurs to do work. So, and this is his friend Art, which is also actually met him, still alive today, who was... it's interesting how they met. He heard about Greg through the Rocketry Society or something, and he found out where he worked, and he knocked on his door and he said, "Are you the mad Roberts who tracks satellites?" And he said, and then they became lifelong friends after that. Johannesburg, very classical picture here. You see Finson at the top there. Come on, Mouse. You see the guy in his Scottish dress there, a girl. You see the guy here with their three-dimensional flight rule, figuring out the orbit, picking up radio stations, and of course that's the dome that's still there today. So Finson, let me just go back for a moment. Finson was the observatory in Johannesburg here stopped work for 1 year. And they just did satellites. They didn't do anything else. And that's probably why they got so good at it, because they got this astronomer to throw all his energy at it. And then after the year, Finson said, "Right, that's it. We're not doing anything anymore." And Johannesburg and Pretoria sort of amalgamated. The people who were interested then moved to Pretoria, and the observatory went on with observatory stuff again. And but for that year, they were basically space mad. And of course, on the amateur side, Danny Overbeek, who a lot of you will definitely know, he was just using his own equipment to track satellites as well. Pretoria, the setup was originally at the Redcliffe Observatory, which is somewhere near Fort Klapperkop, I believe. And so that's the 74-inch telescope that's today in Sutherland. And you can see this is an early picture. This is Joe Chirms, who I actually met as at the observatory still. He's now deceased as well. And they were still using the old telescopes here. And then they later moved onto the roof of one of the CSIR buildings. And people who knows about this will recognize the name, Jack Bennett. In fact, it was one of these scopes, I think, that Jack discovered his first... His first comet, but he's one of South Africa's most well-known comet hunters. So this is a picture of it on the CSIR roof, and you can see also a new type of mounting, because it was easier to align them that way. This is still the old mounting, another one of Jack Bennett and then Roy Smith. I'm not sure if he's there. So these were actually finally they were single people manning stations. And that's why they got sort of individual numbers, and then relaying this information back. Because what they actually did was to track the time of the telescope against background stars, and that will then give them that information. Yeah, another one with Jack Bennett. I'm not sure exactly where this comes in, but you can see different sort of telescopes. And Walter Beek was actually my lecturer at UCT when I... I had UNISA here when I did astronomy back in the day. And so in the first year, you can see the numbers. You can see Johannesburg totaling everybody, probably because of better weather as well, I assume. Pretoria was a close second. Cape Town sort of behind them, and Bloemfontein was trailing a little. Officially in 1975, the Moonwatch program stopped, and so you see the other it wasn't just Moonwatch, there were all these others, and this Western Satellite Research Network is what Greg eventually joined to do the work from Durban. So radio tracking, and this is basically what a satellite will sound like. So what you actually do, well, I understand it, I'm not too sure exactly how radio tracking works, because you can now track satellites in day as well. So they would then actually just receive the telemetry or anything that the satellite produces, and then measure Doppler shift or something. I'm not exactly sure of the... So that's him and his friend Art. And later when Greg moved to the Republic Observatory, one of the first things he did is he put up an antenna there. So the professional tracking, mini track, I don't have too much information about mini track. It sounds like it wasn't very successful. And I've never seen any pictures of it. So it seems like it was dishes, but I also got the feeling it was just a raise of antennas. It needed a radio quiet site, so it was first put up on the Robert College, Eslam Park. I actually spent 3 months there back in the day, and then probably was found too noisy in the radio, and then was finally moved to. It was first going to go to Bloemfontein, by the way, and then decided on Eslam Park. And eventually was moved to Hartbeespoort, where it's very radio quiet. The Baker Nunn cameras, these were amazing Super Smith wide-angle cameras, almost F1. I'll show you the optical thing in a moment. Greg took these pictures when he visited the place, and he actually got a job offer there, and he realized that was not going to... work for him, because he didn't see it as a CCA. You see a 5-inch over there. So there you can see the optical arrangement with film going through the center there, and 4 A-spheres. So to make that thing would have been a nightmare. And this is a picture of one of them of Sputnik actually. So the Baker Nuns were just coming online. And like I've seen a previous slide, there were 12 of them. So the time was actually photographed as well, and they also had shutters to do actually measurements on it. So in Cape Town today, this building is still there. The telescope is long gone. This is called the Kinney Theodolite. It took 2 people to man it, one on both sides, one doing altitude, the other doing azimuth, so you would follow the satellite. Then there was communication, shouts and stuff, and then you push a button or push the thing with your foot, and you take a picture, and also time information on the film. Used 35 millimeter strip film, and so this is what Greg manned when he got down to Cape Town. And he actually roped his wife in, and apparently he could operate this machine by himself, leaning over. the man is just amazing. Yeah. Deep Space Station 51. Any ideas what that is called today? True. Yes. So the original DIS was built for tracking the deep space, the things going to the moon and to the other planets. And then in 75, they basically stopped work, and they said that some of the CSIR guys, which was running this station, was already doing radio astronomy in between satellites. And then they were basically said, okay, we're going to close the station down. And as you see there, they actually left a lot of stuff which they could have taken away. Only the sensitive stuff they've taken away. And this is how radio astronomy was born in South Africa. Yeah, so there's obviously always stories with these things, and so this thing here, I'm not going to read it all, but this sort of gives you a feeling for the excitement of actually finding a satellite. Suddenly the guy saw the satellite, what did he shout? Something, and then yeah, I've got it. Instead of saying satellite or whatever, just so excited, and then remember, okay, he's drilled. You must say pip, and immediately five stopwatches clicked as one, and the reading, and then he says how they do the sort of the timing there, and this was actually the first observation outside the USA of this satellite. Yeah, I like this story about this the girl who was admitting a boyfriend into a room after hours, and then the mother called the police because she saw somebody out there, but this guy was actually waiting to be picked up in, this is now 4 in the morning or somewhere, to go to the observatory, but the cops grabbed him and he didn't want to buy his story, so they actually took him in the car to the observatory to verify his story. So it's the first moon watcher that was ever taken to his job on police escort. And so this is, Greg Roberts has got a tale to tell as well. So this telescope after he finally secured these two telescopes for themselves in Durban, they were delivered and signed for by somebody, and then they disappeared. And of course, Greg was highly peed off about this and so forth. And he finally figured out who it was. The one is actually a comet discoverer, and the comet was discovered with the one stolen telescope. And the other telescope was somebody who I knew from, it's a radio amateur friend of mine, one of the radio amateurs. And this friend of mine got it from this guy, and I gave it back to Greg here 52 years after it was finally back in his hands. So yeah, so just a few slides on Greg. So you can see he's set up, he's taken his Apogee mount and heavily modified it, putting all sorts of cameras on it. You can see it changes every so often, motorized it, and that's the software that I wrote. You can see the different cameras. This is a Mintron and a Watek for different fields of view. He tracks satellites, he changes the configuration. Here he's got a proper CCD camera, which he actually got from the Russians, by the way. And then when he does geostationary satellites, he needed a bit more aperture. So he put a normal EQ, whatever, mount into Alt-As mode, and radio tracking. This is what his control room looked like. In fact, if you don't believe it, that looks like NASA, but it also says NASA on there. And workshop, this guy is just amazing. He can work on electronics, he can work in mechanics. He's a mount evolving there. And this is actually when the Russians visited him. Radio dishes, still onto radio tracking. Made the news a couple of times and managed to upset the Americans by finding their secret spacecraft, and amazing man, and he should have been here. Thank you very much.